Chapter 7 of Xerxes, the preparations of the Greeks for defense, B.C.
480.
We must now leave for a time the operations of Xerxes and his army and turn our attention to the Greeks and to the preparations which they were making to meet the emergency. The two states of Greece which were most prominent in the transactions connected with the invasion of Xerxes were Athens and Sparta. By referring to the map, Athens will be found to have been situated upon a promontory just without the Peloponnesus, while Sparta, on the other hand, was in the center of a valley which lay in the southern part of the peninsula. Each of these cities was the center and stronghold of a small but very energetic and powerful commonwealth. The two states were entirely independent of each other, and each had its own peculiar system of government, of usages, and of laws. These systems, and in fact, the characters of the two communities, in all respects, were extremely dissimilar. Both these states, though in name republics, had certain magistrates, called commonly in history kings. These kings were, however, in fact, only military chieftains, commanders of the armies, rather than sovereign rulers of the state. The name by which such a chieftain was actually called by the people themselves in those days was tyrannus, the name from which our word tyrant is derived. As, however, the word tyrannus had none of that opprobrious import which is associated with its English derivative, the latter is not now a suitable substitute for the former. Historians, therefore, commonly use the word king instead, though the word does not properly express the idea. They were commanders, chieftains, hereditary generals, but not strictly kings. We shall, however, often call them kings in these narratives, in conformity with the general usage. Demaratus, who had fled from Sparta to seek refuge with Darius, and who was now accompanying Xerxes on his march to Greece, was one of these kings. It was a peculiarity in the constitution of Sparta that, from a very early period of its history, there had been always two kings who had each other, like the Roman consuls in later times. This custom was sustained partly by the idea that by this division of the executive power of the state, the exercise of the power was less likely to become despotic or tyrannical. It had its origin, however, according to the ancient legends, in the following singular occurrences. At a very early period in the history of Sparta, when the people had always been accustomed, like other states, to have one prince or chieftain, a certain prince died, leaving his wife, whose name was Argia, and two infant children as his survivors. The children were twins, and the father had died almost immediately after they were born. Now, the office of king was in a certain sense hereditary, and yet not absolutely so, for the people were accustomed to assemble on the death of the king and determine who should be his successor, always choosing, however, the oldest son of the former monarch, unless there was some very extraordinary and imperious reason for not doing so. In this case, they decided, as usual, that the oldest son should be king. But here a very serious difficulty arose, which was to determine which of the twins was the oldest son. They resembled each other so closely that no stranger could distinguish one from the other at all. The mother said that she could not distinguish them, and that she did not know which was the firstborn. This was not strictly true, for she did, in fact, know, and only denied her power to decide the question because she wished to have both of her children kings. In this perplexity, the Spartans sent to the oracle at Delphi to know what they were to do. The oracle gave, as usual, an ambiguous and unsatisfactory response. It directed the people to make both the children kings, but to render the highest honors to the firstborn. When this answer was reported at Sparta, it only increased the difficulty, for how were they to render peculiar honors to the firstborn unless they could ascertain which was the firstborn? In this dilemma, some person suggested to the magistrates that perhaps Argia really knew which was the eldest child, and that if so, by watching her, to see whether she washed and fed one uniformly before the other, or gave it precedence in any other way by which her latent maternal instinct or partiality might appear. The question might possibly be determined. This plan was accordingly adopted. The magistrates contrived means to place a servant maid in the house to watch the mother in the way proposed, and the result was that the true order of birth was revealed. From that time forward, while they were both considered as princes, the one now supposed to be the firstborn took precedence of the other. When, however, the children arrived at an age to assume the exercise of the governmental power, as there was no perceptible difference between them in age or strength or accomplishments, the one who had been decided to be the younger was little disposed to submit to the other. Each had his friends and adherents, parties were formed, and a long and angry civil dissension ensued. In the end, the question was compromised. The command was divided, and the system of having two chief magistrates became gradually established, the power descending in two lines from father to son through many generations. Of course, there was perpetual jealousy and dissension, and often open and terrible conflicts between these two rival lines. The Spartans were an agricultural people, cultivating the valley in the southwestern part of the Peloponnesus, the waters of which were collected and conveyed to the sea by the river Eurotas and its branches. They lived in the plainest possible manner and prided themselves on the stern and stoical resolution with which they rejected all the refinements and luxuries of society. Courage, hardihood, indifference to life, and the power to endure without a murmur the most severe and protracted sufferings were the qualities which they valued. They despised wealth, just as other nations despise effeminacy and foppery. Their laws discouraged commerce, lest it should make some of the people rich. Their clothes were scanty and plain. Their houses were comfortless. Their food was a coarse bread, hard and brown, and their money was of iron. With all this, however, they were the most ferocious and terrible soldiers in the world. They were, moreover, with all their plainness of manners and of life, of a very proud and lofty spirit. All agricultural toil and every other species of manual labor in their state were performed by a servile peasantry, while the free citizens, whose profession was exclusively that of arms, were as aristocratic and exalted in soul as any nobles on earth. People are sometimes, in our day, when money is so much valued, proud, notwithstanding their poverty. The Spartans were proud of their poverty itself. They could be rich if they chose, but they despised riches. They looked down on all the refinements and delicacies of dress and of living from an elevation far above them. They looked down on labor, too, with the same contempt. They were yet very nice and particular about their dress and military appearance, though everything pertaining to both was coarse and simple, and they had slaves to wait upon them, even in their campaigns. The Athenians were a totally different people. The leading classes in their commonwealth were cultivated, intellectual, and refined. The city of Athens was renowned for the splendor of its architecture, its temples, its citadels, its statues, and its various public institutions, which in subsequent times made it the great intellectual center of Europe. It was populous and wealthy. It had a great commerce and a powerful fleet. The Spartan character, in a word, was stern, gloomy, indomitable, and wholly unadorned. The Athenians were rich, intellectual, and refined. The two nations were nearly equal in power and were engaged in a perpetual and incessant rivalry. There were various other states and cities in Greece, but Athens and Sparta were at this time the most considerable, and they were altogether the most resolute and determined in their refusal to submit to the Persian sway. In fact, so well known and understood was the spirit of defiance with which these two powers were disposed to regard the Persian invasion, that when Xerxes sent his summons demanding submission to the other states of Greece, he did not send any to these. When Darius invaded Greece some years before, he had summoned Athens and Sparta as well as the others, but his demands were indignantly rejected. It seems that the custom was for a government or a prince, when acknowledging the dominion of a superior power, to send, as a token of territorial submission, a little earth and water, which was a sort of legal form of giving up possession of their country to the sovereign who claimed it. Accordingly, when Darius sent his ambassadors into Greece to summon the country to surrender, the ambassadors, according to the usual form, called upon the governments of the several states to send earth and water to the king. The Athenians, as has been already said, indignantly refused to comply with this demand. The Spartans, not content with a simple refusal, seized the ambassadors and threw them into a well, telling them as they went down that if they wanted earth and water for the king of Persia, they might get it there. The Greeks had obtained some information of Xerxes' designs against them before they received his summons. The first intelligence was communicated to the Spartans by Demaratus himself while he was at Susa in the following singular manner. It was the custom in those days to write with a steel point on a smooth surface of wax. The wax was spread for this purpose on a board or tablet of metal in a very thin stratum, forming a ground upon which the letters traced with the point were easily legible. Demaratus took two writing tablets such as these, and removing the wax from them, he wrote a brief account of the proposed Persian invasion by tracing the characters upon the surface of the wood or metal itself beneath. Then, restoring the wax so as to conceal the letters, he sent the two tablets, seemingly blank, to Leonidas, king of Sparta. The messengers who bore them had other pretexts for their journey, and they had various other articles to carry. The Persian guards who stopped and examined the messengers from time to time along the route thought nothing of the blank tablets, and so they reached Leonidas in safety. Leonidas, being a blunt, rough soldier, and not much accustomed to cunning contrivances himself, was not usually much upon the watch for them from others, and when he saw no obvious communication upon the tablets, he threw them aside, not knowing what the sending of them could mean, and not feeling any strong interest in ascertaining. His wife, however, her name was Gorgo, had more curiosity. There was something mysterious about the affair, and she wished to solve it. She examined the tablets attentively in every part, and at length removed cautiously a little of the wax. The letters began to appear, full of excitement and pleasure. She proceeded with the work until the whole serious coating was removed. The result was that the communication was revealed, and Greece received the warning. When the Greeks heard that Xerxes was at Sardis, they sent 3 messengers in disguise to ascertain the facts in respect to the Persian army assembled there, and so far as possible to learn the plans and designs of the king. Notwithstanding all the efforts of these men to preserve their concealment and disguise, they were discovered, seized, and tortured by the Persian officers who took them, until they confessed that they were spies. The officer was about to put them to death when Xerxes himself received information of the circumstances. He forbade the execution and directed, on the other hand, that the men should be conducted through all his encampments and be allowed to view and examine everything. He then dismissed them with orders to return to Greece and report what they had seen. He thought, he said, that the Greeks would be more likely to surrender if they knew how immense his preparations were for effectually vanquishing them if they attempted resistance. The city of Athens, being farther north than Sparta, would be the one first exposed to danger from the invasion. And when the people heard of Xerxes' approach, the whole city was filled with anxiety and alarm. Some of the inhabitants were panic-stricken and wished to submit. Others were enraged and uttered nothing but threats and defiance. 1,000 different plans of defense were proposed and eagerly discussed. At length, the government sent messengers to the oracle at Delphi to learn what their destiny was to be and to obtain, if possible, divine direction in respect to the best mode of averting the danger. The messengers received an awful response, portending in wild and solemn, though dark and mysterious language, the most dreadful calamities to the ill-fated city. The messengers were filled with alarm at hearing this reply. One of the inhabitants of Delphi, the city in which the oracle was situated, proposed to them to make a second application in the character of the most humble supplicants, and to implore that the oracle would give them some directions in respect to the best course for them to pursue in order to avoid, or at least to mitigate, the impending danger. They did so, and after a time they received an answer, vague, mysterious, and almost unintelligible, but which seemed to denote that the safety of the city was connected in some manner with Salamis and with certain wooden walls, to which the inspired distich of the response obscurely alluded. The messengers returned to Athens and reported the answer which they had received. The people were puzzled and perplexed in their attempts to understand it. It seems that the citadel of Athens had been formerly surrounded by a wooden palisade. Some thought that this was what was referred to by the wooden walls, and that the meaning of the oracle was that they must rebuild the palisade and then retreat to the citadel when the Persians should approach and defend themselves there. Others conceived that the phrase referred to ships, and that the oracle meant to direct them to meet their enemies with a fleet upon the sea. Salamis, which was also mentioned by the oracle, was an island not far from Athens, being west of the city, between it and the Isthmus of Corinth. Those who supposed that by the wooden walls was denoted the fleet thought that Salamis might have been alluded to as the place near which the great naval battle was to be fought. This was the interpretation which seemed finally to prevail. The Athenians had a fleet of about 200 galleys. These vessels had been purchased and built some time before this for the Athenian government through the influence of a certain public officer of high rank and influence named Themistocles. It seems that a large sum had accumulated in the public treasury, the produce of certain mines belonging to the city, and a proposal was made to divide it among the citizens, which would have given a small sum to each man. Themistocles opposed this proposition and urged instead that the government should build and equip a fleet with the money. This plan was finally adopted. The fleet was built, and it was now determined to call it into active service to meet and repel the Persians, though the naval armament of Xerxes was six times as large. The next measure was to establish a confederation, if possible, of the Grecian states, or at least of all those who were willing to combine, and thus to form an allied army to resist the invader. The smaller states were very generally panic-stricken and had either already signified their submission to the Persian rule or were timidly hesitating in doubt whether it would be safer for them to submit to the overwhelming force which was advancing against them, or to join the Athenians and the Spartans in their almost desperate attempts to resist it. The Athenians and Spartans settled for the time their own quarrels and held a council to take the necessary measures for forming a more extended confederation. All this took place while Xerxes was slowly advancing from Sardis to the Hellespont and from the Hellespont to Doriscus, as described in the preceding chapter. The council resolved on dispatching an embassy at once to all the states of Greece, as well as to some of the remoter neighboring powers, asking them to join the alliance. The first Greek city to which these ambassadors came was Argos, which was the capital of a kingdom or state lying between Athens and Sparta, though within the Peloponnesus. The states of Argos and of Sparta, being neighbors, had been constantly at war. Argos had recently lost 6,000 men in a battle with the Spartans and were consequently not likely to be in a very favorable mood for a treaty of friendship and alliance. When the ambassadors had delivered their message, the Argolians replied that they had anticipated such a proposal from the time that they had heard that Xerxes had commenced his march toward Greece, and that they had applied accordingly to the oracle at Delphi to know what it would be best for them to do in case the proposal were made. The answer of the oracle had been, they said, unfavorable to their entering into an alliance with the Greeks. They were willing, however, they added, notwithstanding this, to enter into an alliance, offensive and defensive, with the Spartans for 30 years, on condition that they should themselves have the command of half the Peloponnesian troops. They were entitled to the command of the whole, being, as they contended, the superior nation in rank, but that they would waive their just claim and be satisfied with half if the Spartans would agree to that arrangement. The Spartans replied that they could not agree to those conditions. They were themselves, they said, the superior nation in rank and entitled to the whole command. And as they had two kings and Argos but one, there was a double difficulty in complying with the Argive demand. They could not surrender one half of the command without depriving one of their kings of his rightful power. Thus, the proposed alliance failed entirely, the people of Argos saying that they would as willingly submit to the dominion of Xerxes as to the insolent demands and assumptions of superiority made by the government of Sparta. The ambassadors, among other countries which they visited in their attempts to obtain alliance and aid, went to Sicily. Gallen was the king of Sicily, and Syracuse was his capital. Here the same difficulty occurred, which had broken up the negotiations at Argos. The ambassadors, when they arrived at Syracuse, represented to Gallen that if the Persians subdued Greece, they would come to Sicily next, and that it was better for him and his countrymen that they should meet the enemy while he was still at a distance, rather than to wait until he came near. Gallen admitted the justice of this reasoning and said that he would furnish a large force, both of ships and men, for carrying on the war, provided that he might have the command of the combined army. To this, of course, the Spartans would not agree. He then asked that he might command the fleet on condition of giving up his claim to the land forces. This proposition the Athenian ambassadors rejected, saying to Gallen that what they were in need of and came to him to obtain was a supply of troops, not of leaders. The Athenians, they said, were to command the fleet, being not only the most ancient nation of Greece, but also the most immediately exposed to the invasion, so that they were doubly entitled to be considered as the principals and leaders in the war. Gallen then told the ambassadors that, since they wished to obtain everything and to concede nothing, they had better leave his dominions without delay and report to their countrymen that they had nothing to expect from Sicily. The ambassadors then went to Corcyra, a large island on the western coast of Greece in the Adriatic Sea. It is now called Corfu. Here they seemed to meet with their first success. The people of Corcyra acceded to the proposals made to them and promised at once to equip and man their fleet and send it round into the Aegean Sea. They immediately engaged in the work and seemed to be honestly intent on fulfilling their promises. They were, however, in fact only pretending. They were really undecided which cause to espouse, the Greek or the Persian, and kept their promised squadron back by means of various delays until its aid was no longer needed. But the most important of all these negotiations of the Athenians and Spartans with the neighboring states were those opened with Thessaly. Thessaly was a kingdom in the northern part of Greece. It was, therefore, the territory which the Persian armies would first enter on turning the northwestern corner of the Aegean Sea. There were, moreover, certain points in its geographical position and in the physical conformation of the country that gave it a peculiar importance in respect to the approaching conflict. By referring to the map placed at the commencement of the fifth chapter, it will be seen that Thessaly was a vast valley surrounded on all sides by mountainous land and drained by the river Peneus and its branches. The Peneus flows eastwardly to the Aegean Sea and escapes from the great valley through a narrow and romantic pass lying between the mountains Olympus and Ossa. This pass was called in ancient times the Olympic Straits, and a part of it formed a romantic and beautiful glen called the Vale of Tempe. There was a road through this pass, which was the only access by which Thessaly could be entered from the eastward. To the south of the Vale of Tempe, the mountains, as will appear from the map, crowded so hard upon the sea as not to allow any passage to the eastward of them. The natural route of Xerxes, therefore, in descending into Greece, would be to come down along the coast until he reached the mouth of the Peneus, and then following the river up through the Vale of Tempe into Thessaly to pass down toward the Peloponnesus on the western side of Ossa and Pelion and of the other mountains near the sea, if he could get through the Olympic Straits and the Vale of Tempe, the way would be open and unobstructed until he should reach the southern frontier of Thessaly, where there was another narrow pass leading from Thessaly into Greece. This last defile was close to the sea and was called the Straits of Thermopylae. Thus Xerxes and his hosts, in continuing their march to the southward, must necessarily traverse Thessaly, and in doing so they would have two narrow and dangerous defiles to pass, one at Mount Olympus to get into the country, and the other at Thermopylae to get out of it. It consequently became a point of great importance to the Greeks to determine at which of these two passes they should make their stand against the torrent which was coming down upon them. This question would, of course, depend very much upon the disposition of Thessaly herself. The government of that country, understanding the critical situation in which they were placed, had not waited for the Athenians and Spartans to send ambassadors to them, but at a very early period of the war, before in fact Xerxes had yet crossed the Hellespont, had sent messengers to Athens to concert some plan of action. These messengers were to say to the Athenians that the government of Thessaly were expecting every day to receive a summons from Xerxes, and that they must speedily decide what they were to do, that they themselves were very unwilling to submit to him, but that they could not undertake to make a stand against his immense host alone, that the southern Greeks might include Thessaly in their plan of defense or exclude it, just as they thought best. If they decided to include it, then they must make a stand at the Olympic Straits, that is, at the pass between Olympus and Ossa. And to do that, it would be necessary to send a strong force immediately to take possession of the pass. If, on the contrary, they decided not to defend Thessaly, then the pass of Thermopylae would be the point at which they must make their stand, and in that case, Thessaly must be at liberty to submit on the first Persian summons. The Greeks, after consultation on the subject, decided that it would be best for them to defend Thessaly and to take their stand accordingly at the Straits of Olympus. They immediately put a large force on board their fleet, armed and equipped for the expedition. This was at the time when Xerxes was just about crossing the Hellespont. The fleet sailed from the port of Athens, passed up through the narrow strait called Euripus, lying between the island of Euboea and the mainland, and finally landed at a favorable point of disembarkation south of Thessaly. From this point, the forces marched to the northward until they reached the Peneus, and then established themselves at the narrowest part of the passage between the mountains, strengthened their position there as much as possible, and awaited the coming of the enemy. The amount of the force was 10,000 men. They had not been here many days before a messenger came to them from the king of Macedon, which country, it will be seen, lies immediately north of Thessaly, earnestly dissuading them from attempting to make a stand at the Vale of Tempe. Xerxes was coming on, he said, with an immense and overwhelming force, one against which it would be utterly impossible for them to make good their defense at such a point as that. It would be far better for them to fall back to Thermopylae, which, being a narrower and more rugged pass, could be more easily defended. Besides this, the messenger said that it was possible for Xerxes to enter Thessaly without going through the Vale of Tempe at all. The country between Thessaly and Macedon was mountainous, but it was not impassable, and Xerxes would very probably come by that way. The only security, therefore, for the Greeks would be to fall back and entrench themselves at Thermopylae. Nor was there any time to be lost. Xerxes was crossing the Hellespont, and the whole country was full of excitement and terror. The Greeks determined to act upon this advice. They broke up their encampment at the Olympic Straits, and retreating to the southward, established themselves at Thermopylae to await there the coming of the conqueror. The people of Thessaly then surrendered to Xerxes as soon as they received his summons. Xerxes, from his encampment at Therma, where we left him at the close of the last chapter, saw the peaks of Olympus and Ossa in the southern horizon. They were distant, perhaps 50 miles from where he stood. He inquired about them, and was told that the river Peneus flowed between them to the sea, and that through the same defile there lay the main entrance to Thessaly. He had previously determined to march his army round the other way, as the king of Macedon had suggested, but he said that he should like to see this defile. So he ordered a swift Sidonian galley to be prepared, and taking with him suitable guides and a fleet of other vessels in attendance on his galley, he sailed to the mouth of the Peneus, and entering that river, he ascended it till he came to the defile. Seen from any of the lower elevations which projected from the bases of the mountains at the head of this defile, Thessaly lay spread out before the eye as one vast valley, level, verdant, fertile, and bounded by distant groups and ranges of mountains, which formed a blue and beautiful horizon on every side. Through the midst of this scene of rural loveliness, the Peneus, with its countless branches,
gracefully
meandered, gathering the water from every part of the valley, and then pouring it forth in a deep and calm current through the gap in the mountains at the observer's feet. Xerxes asked his guides if it would be possible to find any other place where the waters of the Peneus could be conducted to the sea. They replied that it would not be, for the valley was bounded on every side by ranges of mountainous land. Then, said Xerxes, the Thessalonians were wise in submitting at once to my summons, for if they had not done so, I would have raised a vast embankment across the valley here, and thus stopped the river, turned their country into a lake, and drowned them all. End of chapter 7.
Chapter 8 of Xerxes. The advance of Xerxes into Greece, B.C. 480. From Therma, the last of the great stations at which the Persian army halted before its final descent upon Greece, the army commenced its march, and the fleet set sail nearly at the same time, which was early in the summer. The army advanced slowly, meeting with the usual difficulties and delays, but without encountering any special or extraordinary occurrences until, after having passed through Macedon into Thessaly, and through Thessaly to the northern frontier of Phocis, they began to approach the straits of Thermopylae. What took place at Thermopylae will be made the subject of the next chapter. The movements of the fleet are to be narrated in this. In order distinctly to understand these movements, it is necessary that the reader should first have a clear conception of the geographical conformation of the coasts and seas along which the path of the expedition lay. By referring to the map of Greece, we shall see that the course which the fleet would naturally take from Therma to the southeastward along the coast was unobstructed and clear for about 100 miles. We then come to a group of 4 islands extending in a range at right angles to the coast. The only one of these islands with which we have particularly to do in this history is the innermost of them, which was named Cyathus. Opposite to these islands, the line of the coast, having passed around the point of a mountainous and rocky promontory called Magnesia, turns suddenly to the westward and runs in that direction for about 30 miles. When it again turns to the southward and eastward as before. In the sort of corner thus cut off by the deflection of the coast lies the long island of Euboea, which may be considered, in fact, as almost a continuation of the continent, as it is a part of the same conformation of country, and is separated from the main land only by submerged valleys on the north and on the east. Into these sunken valleys, the sea of course flows, forming straits or channels. The one on the north was in ancient times called Artemisium, and the one on the west, at its narrowest point, Euripus. All these islands and coasts were high and picturesque. They were also, in the days of Xerxes, densely populated and adorned profusely with temples, citadels, and towns. On passing the southernmost extremity of the island of Euboea and turning to the westward, we come to a promontory of the mainland, which constituted Attica, and in the middle of which the city of Athens was situated. Beyond this is a capacious gulf called the Saronian Gulf. It lies between Attica and the Peloponnesus. In the middle of the Saronian Gulf lies the island of Aegina, and in the northern part of it, the island of Salamis. The progress of the Persian fleet was from Therma down the coast to Cyathus, thence along the shores of Euboea to its southern point, and so round into the Saronian Gulf to the island of Salamis. The distance of this voyage was perhaps 250 miles. In accomplishing it, the fleet encountered many dangers and met with a variety of incidents and events which we shall now proceed to describe. The country, of course, was everywhere in a state of the greatest excitement and terror. The immense army was slowly coming down by land, and the fleet, scarcely less terrible, since its descents upon the coast would be so fearfully sudden and overwhelming when they were made, was advancing by sea. The inhabitants of the country were consequently in a state of extreme agitation. The sick and the infirm, who were, of course, utterly helpless in such a danger, exhibited everywhere the spectacle of silent dismay. Mothers, wives, maidens, and children, on the other hand, were wild with excitement and terror. The men, too full of passion to fear, or too full of pride to allow their fears to be seen, were gathering in arms, or hurrying to and fro with intelligence, or making hasty arrangements to remove their wives and children from the scenes of cruel suffering which were to ensue. They stationed watchmen on the hills to give warning of the approach of the enemy. They agreed upon signals and raised piles of wood for beacon fires on every commanding elevation along the coast, while all the roads leading from the threatened provinces to other regions more remote from the danger were covered with flying parties endeavoring to make their escape and carrying wearily and in sorrow, whatever they valued most and were most anxious to save. Mothers bore their children, men their gold and silver, and sisters aided their sick or feeble brothers to sustain the toil and terror of the flight. All this time Xerxes was sitting in his war chariot in the midst of his advancing army, full of exultation, happiness, and pride at the thoughts of the vast harvest of glory which all this panic and suffering were bringing him in. The fleet at length, which was under the command of Xerxes' brothers and cousins, whom he had appointed the admirals of it, began to move down the coast from Therma, with the intention of first sweeping the seas clear of any naval force which the Greeks might have sent forward there to act against them, and then of landing upon some point on the coast, wherever they could do so most advantageously, for cooperation with the army on the land. The advance of the ships was necessarily slow. So immense a flotilla could not have been otherwise kept together. The admirals, however, selected 10 of the swiftest of the galleys, and after manning and arming them in the most perfect manner, sent them forward to reconnoiter. The 10 galleys were ordered to advance rapidly, but with the greatest circumspection. They were not to incur any needless danger, but if they met with any detached ships of the enemy, they were to capture them if possible. They were, moreover, to be constantly on the alert, to observe everything, and to send back to the fleet all important intelligence which they could obtain. The 10 galleys went on without observing anything remarkable until they reached the island of Cyathus. Here they came in sight of 3 Greek ships, a sort of advanced guard which had been stationed there to watch the movements of the enemy. The Greek galleys immediately hoisted their anchors and fled. The Persian galleys manned their oars and pressed on after them. They overtook one of the guard ships very soon, and after a short conflict, they succeeded in capturing it. The Persians made prisoners of the officers and crew, and then selecting from among them the fairest and most noble-looking man, just as they would have selected a bullock from a herd, they sacrificed him to one of their deities on the prow of the captured ship. This was a religious ceremony intended to signalize and sanctify their victory. The second vessel they also overtook and captured. The crew of this ship were easily subdued, as the overwhelming superiority of their enemies appeared to convince them that all resistance was hopeless and to plunge them into despair. There was one man, however, who, it seems, could not be conquered. He fought like a tiger to the last, and only ceased to deal his furious thrusts and blows at the enemies that surrounded him, when, after being entirely covered with wounds, he fell faint and nearly lifeless upon the bloody deck. When the conflict with him was thus ended, the murderous hostility of his enemies seemed suddenly to be changed into pity for his sufferings and admiration of his valor. They gathered around him, bathed and bound up his wounds, gave him cordials, and at length restored him to life. Finally, when the detachment returned to the fleet some days afterward, they carried this man with them and presented him to their commanders as a hero worthy of the highest admiration and honor. The rest of the crew were made slaves. The third of the Greek guard ships contrived to escape, or rather the crew escaped, while the vessel itself was taken. This ship, in its flight, had gone toward the north, and the crew at last succeeded in running it on shore on the coast of Thessaly so as to escape themselves by abandoning the vessel to the enemy. The officers and crew, thus escaping to the shore, went through Thessaly into Greece, spreading the tidings everywhere that the Persians were at hand. This intelligence was communicated also along the coast by beacon fires, which the people of Cyathus built upon the heights of the island as a signal to give the alarm to the country southward of them, according to the preconcerted plan. The alarm was communicated by other fires built on other heights, and sentinels were stationed on every commanding eminence on the highlands of Euboea toward the south to watch for the first appearance of the enemy. The Persian galleys that had been sent forward, having taken the three Greek guardships and finding the sea before them, now clear of all appearances of an enemy, concluded to return to the fleet with their prizes and their report. They had been directed, when they were dispatched from the fleet, to lay up a monument of stones at the furthest point which they should reach in their cruise, a measure often resorted to in similar cases by way of furnishing proof that a party thus sent forward have really advanced as far as they pretend on their return. The Persian detachment had actually brought the stones for the erection of their landmark with them in one of their galleys. The galley containing the stones and two others to aid it pushed on beyond Cyathus to a small rocky islet standing in a conspicuous position in the sea, and there they built their monument or cairn. The detachment then returned to meet the fleet. The time occupied by this whole expedition was 11 days. The fleet was, in the meantime, coming down along the coast of Magnesia. The whole company of ships had advanced safely and prosperously thus far, but now a great calamity was about to befall them, the first of the series of disasters by which the expedition was ultimately ruined. It was a storm at sea. The fleet had drawn up for the night in a long and shallow bay on the coast. There was a rocky promontory at one end of this bay, and a cape on the other, with a long beach between them. It was a very good place of refuge and rest for the night in calm weather, but such a bay afforded very little shelter against a tempestuous wind, or even against the surf and swell of the sea, which were sometimes produced by a distant storm. When the fleet entered this bay in the evening, the sea was calm and the sky serene. The commanders expected to remain there for the night and to proceed on the voyage on the following day. The bay was not sufficiently extensive to allow of the drawing up of so large a fleet in a single line along the shore. The ships were accordingly arranged in several lines, 8 in all. The innermost of these lines was close to the shore. The others were at different distances from it, and every separate ship was held to the place assigned it by its anchors. In this position, the fleet passed the night in safety, but before morning there were indications of a storm. The sky looked wild and lurid. A heavy swell came rolling in from the offing. The wind began to rise and to blow in fitful gusts. Its direction was from the eastward, so that its tendency was to drive the fleet upon the shore. The seamen were anxious and afraid, and the commanders of the several ships began to devise, each for his own vessel, the best means of safety. Some, whose vessels were small, drew them up upon the sand, above the reach of the swell. Others strengthened the anchoring tackle, or added new anchors to those already down. Others raised their anchors altogether, and attempted to row their galleys away, up or down the coast, in hope of finding some better place of shelter. Thus all was excitement and confusion in the fleet. through the eager efforts made by every separate crew to escape the impending danger. In the meantime, the storm came on apace. The rising and roughening sea made the oars useless, and the wind howled frightfully through the cordage and the rigging. The galleys soon began to be forced away from their moorings. Some were driven upon the beach and dashed to pieces by the waves. Some were wrecked on the rocks at one or the other of the projecting points which bounded the bay on either hand. Some foundered at their place of anchorage. Vast numbers of men were drowned. Those who escaped to the shore were in hourly dread of an attack from the inhabitants of the country. To save themselves, if possible, from this danger, they dragged up the fragments of the wrecked vessels upon the beach and built a fort with them on the shore. Here they entrenched themselves and then prepared to defend their lives, armed with the weapons which, like the materials for their fort, were washed up from time to time by the sea. The storm continued for 3 days. It destroyed about 300 galleys, besides an immense number of provision transports and other smaller vessels. Great numbers of seamen also were drowned. The inhabitants of the country along the coast enriched themselves with the plunder which they obtained from the wrecks and from the treasures and the gold and silver vessels, which continued for some time to be driven up upon the beach by the waves. The Persians themselves recovered, it was said, a great deal of valuable treasure by employing a certain Greek diver whom they had in their fleet to dive for it after the storm was over. This diver, whose name was Silius, was famed far and wide for his power of remaining under water. As an instance of what they believed him capable of performing, they said that when, at a certain period subsequent to these transactions, he determined to desert to the Greeks, he accomplished his design by diving into the sea from the deck of a Persian galley and coming up again in the midst of the Greek fleet, 10 miles distant. After 3 days, the storm subsided. The Persians then repaired the damages which had been sustained, so far as it was now possible to repair them, collected what remained of the fleet, took the shipwrecked mariners from their rude fortification on the beach, and set sail again on their voyage to the southward. In the meantime, the Greek fleet had assembled in the arm of the sea lying north of Euboea and between Euboea and the mainland. It was an allied fleet made up of contributions from various states that had finally agreed to come into the Confederacy. As is usually the case, however, with allied or confederate forces, they were not well agreed among themselves. The Athenians had furnished far the greater number of ships, and they considered themselves, therefore, entitled to the command. But the other allies were envious and jealous of them on account of that very superiority of wealth and power, which enabled them to supply a greater portion of the naval force than the rest. They were willing that one of the Spartans should command, but they would not consent to put themselves under an Athenian. If an Athenian leader were chosen, they would disperse, they said, and the various portions of the fleet return to their respective homes. The Athenians, though burning with resentment at this unjust declaration, were compelled to submit to the necessity of the case. They could not take the Confederates at their word and allow the fleet to be broken up, for the defense of Athens was the great object for which it was assembled. The other states might make their peace with the conqueror by submission, but the Athenians could not do so. In respect to the rest of Greece, Xerxes wished only for dominion. In respect to Athens, he wished for vengeance. The Athenians had burned the Persian city of Sardis, and he had determined to give himself no rest until he had burned Athens in return. It was well understood, therefore, that the assembling of the fleet and giving battle to the Persians where they now were was a plan adopted mainly for the defense and benefit of the Athenians. The Athenians accordingly waived their claim to command, secretly resolving that, when the war was over, they would have their revenge for the insult and injury. A Spartan was accordingly appointed commander of the fleet. His name was Eurybiades. Things were in this state when the two fleets came in sight of each other in the strait between the northern end of Euboea and the mainland. 15 of the Persian galleys, advancing incautiously some miles in front of the rest, came suddenly upon the Greek fleet, and all were captured. The crews were made prisoners and sent into Greece. The remainder of the fleet entered the strait and anchored at the eastern extremity of it, sheltered by the promontory of Magnesia, which now lay to the north of them. The Greeks were amazed at the immense magnitude of the Persian fleet, and the first opinion of the commanders was that it was wholly useless for them to attempt to engage them. A council was convened, and after a long and anxious debate, they decided that it was best to retire to the southward. The inhabitants of Euboea, who had been already in a state of great excitement and terror at the near approach of so formidable an enemy, were thrown by this decision of the allies into a state of absolute dismay. It was abandoning them to irremediable and hopeless destruction. The government of the island immediately raised a very large sum of money and went with it to Themistocles, one of the most influential of the Athenian leaders, and offered it to him if he would contrive any way to persuade the commanders of the fleet to remain and give the Persians battle where they were. Themistocles took the money and agreed to the condition. He went with a small part of it, though this part was a very considerable sum, to Eurybiades, the commander-in-chief, and offered it to him if he would retain the fleet in its present position. There were some other similar offerings made to other influential men, judiciously selected. All this was done in a very private manner, and of course Themistocles took care to reserve to himself the lion's share of the Euboean contribution. The effect of this money in altering the opinions of the naval officers was marvelous. A new council was called, the former decision was annulled, and the Greeks determined to give their enemies battle where they were. The Persians had not been unmindful of the danger that the Greeks might retreat by retiring through the Euripus and so escape them. In order to prevent this, they secretly sent off a fleet of 200 of their strongest and fleetest galleys with orders to sail round Euboea and enter the Euripus from the south, so as to cut off the retreat of the Greeks in that quarter. They thought that by this plan the Greek fleet would be surrounded and could have no possible mode of escape. They remained, therefore, with the principal fleet at the outer entrance of the northern strait for some days before attacking the Greeks, in order to give time for the detachment to pass round the island. The Persians sent off the 200 galleys with great secrecy, not desiring that the Greeks should discover their design of thus intercepting their retreat. They did discover it, however, for this was the occasion on which the great diver, Silius, made his escape from one fleet to the other by swimming under water 10 miles, and he brought the Greeks the tidings. The Greeks dispatched a small squadron of ships with orders to proceed southward into the Euripus to meet this detachment which the Persians sent round, and in the meantime they determined themselves to attack the main Persian fleet without any delay, notwithstanding their absurd dissensions and jealousies, and the extent to which the leaders were influenced by intrigues and bribes, the Greeks always evinced an undaunted and indomitable spirit when the day of battle came. It was, moreover, in this case, exceedingly important to defend the position which they had taken. By referring to the map once more, it will be seen that the Euripus was the great highway to Athens by sea, as the pass of Thermopylae was by land. Thermopylae was west of Artemisium, where the fleet was now stationed, and not many miles from it. The Greek army had made its great stand at Thermopylae, and Xerxes was fast coming down the country with all his forces to endeavor to force a passage there. The Persian fleet, in entering Artemisium, was making the same attempt by sea in respect to the narrow passage of Euripus, and for either of the two forces, the fleet or the army, to fail of making good the defense of its position without a desperate effort to do so would justly be considered a base betrayal and abandonment of the other. The Greeks therefore advanced one morning to the attack of the Persians, to the utter astonishment of the latter, who believed that their enemies were insane when they thus saw them coming into the jaws, as they thought, of certain destruction. Before night, however, they were to change their opinions in respect to the insanity of their foes. The Greeks pushed boldly on into the midst of the Persian fleet, where they were soon surrounded. They then formed themselves into a circle with the prows of the vessels outward and the sterns toward the center within, and fought in this manner with the utmost desperation all the day. With the night a storm came on, or rather a series of thunder showers and gusts of wind, so severe that both fleets were glad to retire from the scene of contest. The Persians went back toward the east, the Greeks to the westward, toward Thermopylae, each party busy in repairing their wrecks, taking care of their wounded, and saving their vessels from the tempest. It was a dreadful night. The Persians particularly spent it in the midst of scenes of horror. The wind and the current, it seems, set outward toward the sea, and carried the masses and fragments of the wrecked vessels and the swollen and ghastly bodies of the dead in among the Persian fleet, and so choked up the surface of the water that the oars became entangled and useless. The whole mass of seamen in the Persian fleet during this terrible night were panic-stricken and filled with horror. The wind, the perpetual thunder, the concussions of the vessels with the wrecks and with one another, and the heavy shocks of the seas kept them in continual alarm, and the black and inscrutable darkness was rendered the more dreadful while it prevailed by the hideous spectacle which, at every flash of lightning, glared brilliantly upon every eye from the wide surface of the sea. The shouts and cries of officers vociferating orders, of wounded men writhing in agony, of watchmen and sentinels in fear of collisions, mingled with the howling wind and roaring seas, created a scene of indescribable terror and confusion. The violence of the sudden gale was still greater further out at sea, and the detachment of ships which had been sent around Euboea was wholly dispersed and destroyed by it. The storm was, however, after all, only a series of summer evening showers, such as to the inhabitants of peaceful dwellings on the land have no terror, but only come to clear the sultry atmosphere in the night, and in the morning are gone. When the sun rose accordingly upon the Greeks and Persians on the morning after their conflict, the air was calm, the sky serene, and the sea as blue and pure as ever. The bodies and the wrecks had been floated away into the offing. The courage or the ferocity, whichever we choose to call it, of the combatants returned, and they renewed the conflict. It continued with varying success for 2 more days. During all this time, the inhabitants of the island of Euboea were in the greatest distress and terror. They watched these dreadful conflicts from the heights, uncertain how the struggle would end, but fearing lest their defenders should be beaten, in which case the whole force of the Persian fleet would be landed on their island to sweep it with pillage and destruction. They soon began to anticipate the worst, and in preparation for it, they removed their goods, all that could be removed, and drove their cattle down to the southern part of the island, so as to be ready to escape to the mainland. The Greek commanders, finding that the fleet would probably be compelled to retreat in the end, sent to them here, recommending that they should kill their cattle and eat them, roasting the flesh at fires which they should kindle on the plain. The cattle could not be transported, they said, across the channel, and it was better that the flying population should be fed than that the food should fall into Persian hands. If they would dispose of their cattle in this manner, Eurybiades would endeavor, he said, to transport the people themselves and their valuable goods across into Attica. How many thousand peaceful and happy homes were broken up and destroyed forever by this ruthless invasion? In the meantime, the Persians, irritated by the obstinate resistance of the Greeks, were on the 4th day preparing for some more vigorous measures when they saw a small boat coming toward the fleet from down the channel. It proved to contain a countryman who came to tell them that the Greeks had gone away. The whole fleet, he said, had sailed off to the southward and abandoned those seas altogether. The Persians did not at first believe this intelligence. They suspected some ambuscade or stratagem. They advanced slowly and cautiously down the channel. When they had gone half down to Thermopylae, they stopped at a place called Histiaea, where upon the rocks on the shore they found an inscription addressed to the Ionians, who, it will be recollected, had been brought by Xerxes as auxiliaries, contrary to the advice of Artabanus, entreating them not to fight against their countrymen. This inscription was written in large and conspicuous characters on the face of the cliff, so that it could be read by the Ionian seamen as they passed in their galleys. The fleet anchored at Histiaea, the commanders being somewhat uncertain in respect to what it was best to do. Their suspense was very soon relieved by a messenger from Xerxes, who came in a galley up the channel from Thermopylae, with the news that Xerxes had arrived at Thermopylae, had fought a great battle there, defeated the Greeks, and obtained possession of the pass, and that any of the officers of the fleet who chose to do so might come and view the battleground. This intelligence and invitation produced throughout the fleet a scene of the wildest excitement, enthusiasm, and joy. All the boats and smaller vessels of the fleet were put into requisition to carry the officers down. When they arrived at Thermopylae, the tidings all proved true. Xerxes was in possession of the pass, and the Greek fleet was gone. End of chapter 8.